and welcome to Living Black, coming to you from Sydney's Northern Beaches. I'm Karla Grant. In today's program, the Northern Territory's alcohol mandatory treatment laws under fire.
What we've seen is it is an outright racist act implemented by the CLP government.
The statue has to come down.
A statue of a European explorer divides a community.
He's not a hero, he's a destroyer. He killed a lot of our people.
And Indigenous authors from Australia and India on a storytelling mission.
I'm hoping that it will give us exposure to a much larger audience. I'm also hoping for some really interesting conversations between Indian writers and academics and Indigenous writers about the post-colonial experience in India, but also contemporary developments in Indigenous politics here.
But first, the controversial Alcohol Mandatory Treatment Act in the Northern Territory continues to come under fire. With little evidence to show it's working, Aboriginal legal services are questioning the validity of the program, concerned that Aboriginal people are being detained with the threat of jail time. Laura Murphy-Oates investigates.
Davey, a 39-year-old Walpiri man, started drinking heavily at the age of 14.
Just buy grog every day and drink around every day in town. Yeah, we used to drink around in Creek Hills, everywhere. Driving around, drunk, with the cars here.
After several stints in jail for drink driving and alcohol-induced violence, the first at age 15, he decided enough was enough. He gave up the grog 8 years ago and hasn't drunk since.
Okay. My family's grown and I don't want to be still the same, I want to change.
It's a problem that's endemic throughout Davey's hometown of Alice Springs and the Greater Northern Territory. Alcohol-related deaths in the Territory are three times the national average, with alcohol-related hospital admissions more than double. And if the Territory was a country, it would rank second highest in the world for the amount of alcohol drunk per person. For many here, the decision to stop drinking has now been taken out of their hands. Under laws implemented in July last year, if you're put into protective custody for being drunk three times in 2 months, you can be sentenced to 12 weeks mandatory treatment at a rehabilitation facility. So far, more than 400 people have received mandatory treatment, all Indigenous except two.
In the middle of the property, we've got a 20-bed facility for alcohol mandatory treatment.
This Indigenous rehabilitation service houses both mandatory and self-referred clients. Those placed here under the Act are kept under strict supervision, unable to leave without permission from the Alcohol Mandatory Treatment Tribunal, with family visits allowed once a week and 24-hour video surveillance.
So we've got about 13 cameras monitoring clients, I guess, and yeah, it's fairly secure.
The CEO says most have made improvements, with about 15 choosing to stay on. But there's been repeated attempts by some to escape.
I think there's probably two or three clients who have not returned to Kapu.
Under the AMT Act, if you try and leave the rehabilitation facility three times, you face criminal charges, with the possibility of prison terms of up to 3 months.
We'd prefer that the clients didn't receive any jail term or any fines. We'd rather have the client come through, get the residential rehab, which they're due.
This is exactly what happened to a woman which for legal reasons is known as RP. Her lawyer was appointed to RP's case in August last year.
So RP is a 30-plus-year-old woman. She's from a remote Western Australian border community. English is not her first language. She speaks a couple of languages. Her English literacy is very low, very limited education.
She was brought before the tribunal and given 3 months treatment.
The tribunal basically sits in Darwin and it's set up by video link. There was no interpreter available for a woman that I certainly knew by that stage was not someone who had a high level of English by any means, and no advocate for her. And she essentially didn't say much throughout the proceedings, except most of the times that she was addressed, she simply said, "I don't want to go to Kapu." Alice Springs is certainly not her home by any means, not too much family here, and it would mean isolation by some 8 hours from her community, which is something that can be particularly confronting.
After attempting to leave Kapu several times, RP was arrested and brought before the court. She was the first person to face charges for absconding under the Act, but the Aboriginal Legal Service challenged her original treatment order. It was found that the failure to appoint an advocate was a denial of natural justice and an error of law. In a landmark decision, RP was released.
That woman should have been given the option of an advocate, and she wasn't. We're on the public record as saying that it was totally unacceptable.
Up until May this year, there was no advocate available in Alice Springs. Legal Aid says this may not have been the only case where justice was denied.
So either we were just, it was a fluke, and the one case that we did take on because of the criminal charges was found to be, that the process was found to be flawed. That's highly unlikely, I would suggest. I'd suggest there are a lot of cases.
And he believes imposing the threat of criminal charges on problem drinkers is a major flaw.
It flies in the face of recommendations of the Royal Commission into deaths in custody, for example. We shouldn't be going anywhere near criminalising alcohol dependence, and this is a roundabout way of doing that.
This law is totally discriminatory. Let's look at the numbers. Let's look at how many non-Indigenous people have been put through this program.
A six-month review of the law was published earlier this year, with submissions from legal and health bodies, but it only analysed how the legislation can be improved and not whether the program is working.
There's a lot of taxpayers' money going into this program, so the government should be accountable to the public. They should be able to prove to the public this many people went through, this was successful, and it's value for money.
The Health Minister says the Act is still being rolled out and issues such as lack of advocates are being resolved.
People, I think, are using the advocacy service quite appropriately now. We're not hearing that people feel like they're being stripped of their natural justice, human rights, and we're satisfied that the process is respecting people's rights.
But the threat of criminal charges are here to stay.
I know from people working within those facilities, they don't think that asking people to not abscond more than twice is unreasonable. That's the point I'm making.
But it's not asking people, it's giving them a criminal charge for doing it.
That's the decision we made.
So far, seven people have been charged for absconding from treatment centres, but the Department of Health says they've received fines rather than prison sentences.
The peak Indigenous health body in Central Australia says rehabilitation is only part of the picture.
Congress has been advocating for a number of years the introduction of a floor price at the price of beer, so that we increase the really cheap alcohol that causes a lot of the harm, or actually have it removed off the product, removed off the market.
The Tungindjeri Council, who oversee the 18 Indigenous town camps around Alice, conducted groundbreaking alcohol research back in 2002. They submitted recommendations to the Liquor Commission on how the alcohol problem could be tackled.
All that thing got knocked back, all the recommendations that was put forward to them.
They're just being ignored and just coming on with these heavy thing, you know, heavy laws and rules and what suits them, you know.
Especially in Alice Springs, we run by their law. Yeah.
For the Indigenous community, it remains to be seen whether mandatory treatment is yet another heavy-handed law or an effective solution in tackling problem drinking in the Northern Territory.
Laura Murphy-Oates with that report. Earlier, I spoke with Senator Nova Peris about the Northern Territory's controversial Alcohol Mandatory Treatment Act. Senator Peris, thanks for your time.
Pleasure, thank you.
Firstly, what's your view of the Alcohol Mandatory Treatment Act?
Well, the Alcohol Mandatory Treatment Act, by a lot of people in the field that deal with alcohol issues right across the Northern Territory, have come out and said, and they've said it for many months now, that it has deemed as being unsuccessful. You know, you've had a number of Aboriginal people who have been placed in custody to go through treatment, and what they've effectively done is criminalise people with health and alcohol problems, and it's been totally ineffective because the people who have been placed into the system there's been no follow-up after it.
In just over a year, more than 400 people have received mandatory treatment. What kind of message is this sending to the community?
Well, it's pretty much, well, a racist act, isn't it? You know, to have 400 people placed into an institution that tries to rehabilitate Aboriginal people has been deemed ineffective by the professionals looking in at this program. You know, we see alcohol-related violence and problems day in, day out down at Mitchell Street, and none of those people are placed or institutionalised for having an alcohol problem. You know, what we've seen is an outright racist act implemented by the CLP government.
The CLP scrapped the banned drinker registry. What's the ALP's stance on this?
Well, not only the ALP were in total, disbelief that what they did was scrapped the banned drinkers register, which was a very, very effective mechanism, if you liked, to look at dealing with problematic drinkers who were placed on these orders and were banned from buying alcohol. What the BDR did, or the banned drinkers register, first and foremost, it wasn't discriminatory. Everyone who came to the Northern Territory purchased alcohol, myself, anyone, you had to show ID. This did not discriminate. There were almost 3,000 people across the Northern Territory who were placed on the banned drinkers register and weren't allowed to purchase alcohol. And every person in the industry, you know, of dealing with alcohol rehabilitation and that area have all said that the only way that you can tackle alcohol problems is go straight back to the source, and that's dealing with alcohol at the point of sale.
How would you address the alcohol issues in the Northern Territory?
What we've been calling for is for the reinstatement of the banned drinkers registers. We need to implement policies that are relevant to each areas. For example, Alice Springs needs to have its own, Tennant Creek, Catherine, Darwin. We can't have a blanket approach because it just does not work. And what we need to do is listen to the professionals who have come up with the solutions. You know, they feel like they're falling on deaf ears because they're not being listened to. So if we're fair dinkum about dealing with alcohol and the problems that are faced with people who have alcohol problems and the detrimental effects it has right across the Northern Territory, we need to start listening to the people who are professionals in this area.
Coming up on Living Black, a controversial European statue dividing a community.
He massacred it. People in their own country trying to protect their native land.
Welcome back to Living Black, coming to you from Sydney's Northern Beaches. In Alice Springs, elders are calling for a controversial statue to be torn down. They say the image of explorer John McDougall Stewart is a stark reminder of the murder of their ancestors. Laura Murphy Oates has more.
His name is on the major highway, the local jail, and now there's a 4-metre-high statue of him in the centre of town. John Stewart is known as the explorer who traversed the continent south to north and back again. But for some, this isn't something to celebrate. This statement read out at Stewart Park was written by the Arunta and Warramungu elders.
Dear Mr. Stewart, how would you feel if it was us who came from another country? How would you feel if we erected a statue right here where your families gather to glorify this act? Perhaps you would feel like society didn't really respect you at all.
It's a damning indictment of a man they say killed their ancestors and of a town that refuses to recognise it.
The statue has to come down as part and parcel of a movement that's actually going to fight back the racism that people are still living and suffering under today. I think we've got to build it and pull it down ourselves. Thank you.
We're all getting older now, and we got all our grandkids and their children, and we're still under the thumb of the government, even on our homeland. Today we see people walking around with guns, even the police standing around the shop with guns. We want the statue to be torn down because we don't want this man with a gun.
Just a few hundred metres down the road is the Akelia Healing Centre, set up as a meeting place to conserve Indigenous culture.
Families mostly forgot about what happened until they erected this, and they brought the memories back with this great big statue.
Arunta Elder Coco says the statue sends a bad message.
The younger ones ask, what the hell the gun's for? That gun there, that represent him as a hero, which he is not. He massacred people in their own country, trying to protect their native land. He's not a hero. He's a destroyer. He killed a lot of our people.
Elder Betty Pierce spoke in favour of the statue at the unveiling this July.
It's this business of saying MacDill Stewart was a racist. Who in the world are they to know? They must be pretty ancient.
But some are advocating for a more peaceful approach to the town's fraught history.
Alice Springs needs a directional change and needs everyone to jump on board so people can start healing race relations between non-Aboriginal and Aboriginal and what we all stand for. Part of Australian history, and John MacDill Stewart is part of Aboriginal history.
The Scottish explorer undertook six expeditions through South Australia and the Northern Territory in the mid-1800s. In 1860, he became the first explorer to access the centre of Australia. And in 1861, he came close to his goal of reaching the Arafura Sea. A year later, he finally succeeded. Paddy Gibson has been digging up what he says is a hidden history of the expeditions.
It was a strict rule on this military expedition. The only person who's allowed to keep journals is Stewart.
The confrontations at nearby Attack Creek in 1860 and Mount Hay in 1862 were the most violent.
The only reference he gives to shooting is he talks about how the natives were charging at his men, and he said, "I had my men ready to receive them." That's the euphemism he gives for shooting them. But there's a man called Auld who was on that expedition who was actually charged with murder of an Aboriginal person in years later in another frontier incident. Auld gave some recollections 30 years after the event where he actually describes what receive them meant.
When ordered to fire, I aimed at the tall black who at once fell flat. I was congratulated on the good shot I had made.
There was one man called Stephen King who was on that expedition, and he was doing sketches on the sly. I've got here a sketch that he did on the trip of that confrontation at Mount Hay. He calls it the attack by natives near Mount Hay. And Stephen King shows very, very clearly, you can see the men lined up in military formation, they've dismounted, they have their rifles on their shoulder, and they're shooting at these Aboriginal people.
For the Alice Springs mayor, the statue was simply a gift, and its place at Stewart Park in the centre of the town was the logical decision.
I was approached by the John MacDill Stewart branch of the Freemasons to donate a statue to recognise the 150th anniversary of Stewart's journey through Central Australia. That was done back in 2009. Art is always controversial, no matter where it's placed.
He's now working on a solution with the local Aboriginal corporation to quell the discontent.
Aboriginal people of Alice Springs can easily hold some talks with the Alice Springs Town Council about having an Aboriginal person represented in the same park. Charles Perkins, you could have Albert Namajura.
It's taken 4 years to find a home for the controversial statue. But now, just a few months after it's been put up, it's been graffitied and blazoned with the words murderer.
For now, the statue remains standing, a reminder of a colonial past which continues to divide this community.
Laura Murphy Oates reporting there. Indigenous Australians and the Dalit people are collaborating to share their traditions of storytelling in India. It's part of a new program promoting our First Peoples' stories. Liz Deep Jones has more.
It was the launch of Literary Commons, a program based on the idea where communities and cultures share in a cooperative space of creativity as well as build upon common world views.
The project aims to bring together two very exciting literary developments in India and in Australia, which are not really that well known outside of those countries. So in the last 30 years, there has been a huge literary renaissance in Indigenous Australian writing and in what is called as Dalit writing in India. And Dalit writing refers to writers from writing from those who have some kind of an Indigenous background in India. And it's a very complex and long history, and at one point of time, these writers, Indigenous writers, might have been seen as at the lowermost rung of society. And the word Dalit means downtrodden, so these writers have taken up the mantle of Dalit to assert themselves.
In India as well as in Australia, the Indigenous and Dalit community are considered as they have been oppressed and for long centuries and for so many years. And their literature is a very unique in the sense that it represents their aspiration, their ambition, their hope. So by creating such a unique platform where two literary streams would come together, I think this is a very good initiative.
And 12 Indigenous authors from Australia have been chosen to share their stories and aspirations at literary festivals and other engagements in India.
I think that's something, that commonality area, you know, we were all both colonised by the British. So there's the history stuff, but there's also a very strong history of storytelling in both cultures.
While this program brings together two of the oldest human civilizations and boasts two of the oldest storytelling traditions of the world, it's also a program which gives Indigenous authors the opportunity to highlight the injustices Indigenous people face on their own land.
I'm also hoping for some really interesting conversations between Indian writers and academics and Indigenous writers about the post-colonial experience in India, but also contemporary developments in Indigenous politics here.
For a long time, we were deprived of our language, deprived of our education for reading and writing. And so it's only in the last half century or so that we have all these prominent writers coming up. And I am so proud of them. They tell the story from an Aboriginal perspective. It's just wonderful.
Still to come on Living Black, football fever at the Murray Carnival.
Come on, Taz, see you on a beat.
If you have each other's back on the field, I think we can go a long way.
You're watching Living Black, coming to you from Sydney's Northern Beaches. While the South Sydney Rabbitohs continue to celebrate their long-awaited grand final win, across the border in Queensland, the Brisbane native women's team have celebrated their debut in the Murray Carnival. Hannah Hollis reports.
For as long as Patrice Chambers can remember, the Brisbane natives rugby league team has been part of her life.
When I was younger, I was a cheer girl. We'd always go to the natives games.
From cheering to playing, she was destined for a future with the natives.
I've always wanted to play for natives because it's been such a big part of my life.
That dream has finally become a reality, and it all started when the Brisbane local had the idea for a women's team.
Mum said we should just have our own team and go under natives because we've been with natives for so many years.
An idea welcomed with open arms.
I think definitely all the women were, you know, happy about a side going through. And like I know that the men's team and the men's, you know, supporters and staffing and the committee, you know, were very supportive of the women's team coming through for the QMC.
Let's go.
A unanimous decision and the Brisbane Natives women's team was born. The 20-year-old, along with a string of community members, leave their everyday lives behind to make up this competitive side. Patrice is passionate about the game and is planning to take her hobby to a professional level.
I'd love to be an NRL like development coach. Like you go around and help the schools and like the clubs, like the younger players develop skills and teach them how to play. I'd love to do that, yeah.
For player Kelly Watson, pulling on the Natives jersey is a tribute to her father's career. Charles Watson was part of the original Natives team, established 40 years ago.
Yeah, he knows heaps. That's probably where I've learnt it from, really, watching him play all the years.
It may be an amateur competition, but these players have a professional approach and there are no concessions for the team in red, black and yellow.
Okay, let's have our three lines.
You don't get no special treatment, and especially when you're playing carnival football. And the girls, you know, should be applying themselves as, you know, as men do on a football paddock.
But yeah, I've been training really hard. I go to the gym almost every day so I can be at my peak fitness.
The ladies have endured intense training sessions in preparation for their debut game.
If we just stick to our game plan, just keep the communication up, and all, like, if you have each other's back on the field, I think we can go a long way.
The moment Patrice is looking forward to starts before kickoff.
Like a dream come true to play for Natives. I'm like really excited to put on the jersey.
With enthusiasm and a passion for the game, Patrice and her fellow team members are blazing a trail for other women in sport.
Each week on social media, we're asking about the issues that matter to you. This week we asked,
what do you think of the NT's alcohol mandatory treatment law, which gives authorities the power to detain problem drinkers with the possibility of jail time? Peter Jack said, unless the NT government work on the social determinants, health, housing, education and employment, which cause alcoholism, then nothing will change. While Michelle Lee Finneran said, a criminal approach to a social issue.
Thanks for your feedback. Join the conversation on our Twitter and Facebook page. You can also watch this episode again by visiting our website. Next week, we talk to Olympic legend Kathy Freeman about her family, foundation, running career, and that famous gold medal win at the Sydney 2000 Olympic Games.
If you want to talk about my fears and my vulnerabilities and my strengths and my power, and if you want to question who you actually are, you'll find the answers. I find the answers about who I really am in the way in which I am a mother to this girl.
That's next week on Living Black. On behalf of the team, thanks for joining us. I'm Karla Grant. See you next time.
We leave you with pictures of the South Sydney Rabbitohs celebrating their historic grand final win.